Okay, thank you for introduction. So the title of my talk is Analysis of L-convex Function Minimization Algorithms and Application to Auction Theory. And this is a joint work with Kazuo Murata. So here we give my overview of my talk. So in this talk, we consider L-convex function, which is a discrete convexity concept for functions defined on the integer lattice point. And in this talk, we consider the minimization of L-convex function, or more precisely, the minimization of L-natural convex function. And it is a fundamental optimization problem in discrete convex analysis and has various applications such as auction theory, image processing, and discrete optimization. And our first result in this talk is to analyze the number of iterations required by minimization algorithms. And we show the exact bound for the number of iterations of minimization algorithms. This is our first result. And in the second part, we apply this result to auction theory. And we provide a new view from the viewpoint of discrete convex analysis. So we first review the definition of L-convex function. So as Kazuo talked this morning, so in the theory of discrete convex analysis, two types of discrete convexity play important roles. So L-natural convexity and M-natural convexity. And it is shown that the discrete convexity constant has various nice properties at discrete convexity. In particular, they have a nice conjugacy relationship, so through the Legendre transformation. That is, by Legendre transformation, so we can obtain M-natural convex function from L-natural convex function and vice versa. And it is shown that there is a one-to-one correspondence between L-natural convex functions and L-natural convex functions. And also, various minimization algorithms are proposed for L-natural convex functions. And here we briefly review the definition of L-natural convex function. So it is well known that for continuous functions, convexity is equivalent to the so-called midpoint convexity, which is given by this inequality. So the sum of function values at p and q, at p and q are real vectors, is more than or equal to the twice of the function value at midpoint. And L-natural convexity, which is defined for functions on integer lattice point, can be defined by using discrete version of midpoint convexity, which is given by this inequality. And here we consider two vector, integral vectors, p and q, and also consider the midpoint. And midpoint is not integral in general, so we consider integral vectors obtained by component wise rounding up, and also integral vector obtained by component wise rounding down. And we regard these integral vectors as discrete midpoints. And by using these points, we define this discrete midpoint convexity. And this is one definition of L-natural convexity. But so, as Kazuo explained in this morning, so original definition of L-natural convex function is given by using some modularity like this. But so we omit this. In this talk. But important thing is that due to this definition, so L-natural convexity implies some modularity on the integer lattice point. And in particular, L-natural convex function on 0-1 vectors is equivalent to a some modular set function. And here we briefly review, explain some examples of L-natural convex functions. So a quadratic function is given by coefficient matrix A is a L-natural convex function if it satisfies these inequalities. So first inequality means that a non diagonal components are non-positive, and the second inequality means that the sum of the components in each row, each column, is non-negative. And we also have an example of L-natural convex function, which is given by the maximum of the component of vector P minus minimum of the component of vector P. And also, the objective function of the minimum cost tension problem given by this formula is also a good example of L-natural convex function. And we explain steepest descent algorithms for L-natural convex function minimization. And here we consider unconstrained minimization of L-natural convex function minimization G. And so we have a good optimality condition in terms of local minimality like this. And given the vector, integral vector P, it is a global minimum for L-natural convex function minimization. If and only if it is a local minimum with respect to some neighborhood, and the neighborhood is given by like this. So if you consider vector P, then we consider the set of vectors obtained by adding zero vectors like these red points, and also consider integral points obtained by subtracting zero vectors like these purple points. And in this way, we define the neighborhood of vector P. And if vector P is a local optimal in this neighborhood, then it is global minima. So we have this optimal condition. So from this optimal condition, we can easily obtain the minimization algorithm, which we call steepest descent up and down. And in this algorithm, we check the local minimality in the neighborhood like this. And if it is local minimum, then it is also global minimum by the optimality condition. And otherwise, we move to the local minimum point like this. And we repeat these steps until we find local minimum. So this is a steepest descent algorithm up and down. And we also consider a variant of steepest descent algorithm where vector P increases monotonically. So here, so we take the initial vector, which is sufficiently small so that it is a lower bound of some global minimum, like so P star is a global minimum, and P0 is a lower bound of such minimizer. And in each iteration, we check the neighborhood given by adding 0,1 vector to current point. And in each iteration, we move to the local minimum point iteratively. And if we reach the local minimum point, then it is a global minimum. So we refer to this algorithm, steepest descent up. And we can also another variant of steepest descent down, where vector P decreases monotonically. And so we now explain our first result concerning the number of iterations required by steepest descent algorithms. So as previous result, upper bound for the number of iterations are given by Murata and Kolmogorov and myself. And in this talk, we show the exact number of iterations. So first, we consider steepest descent up, so where vector P increases monotonically like this. And here we assume that the domain of function G, so the set of vectors with finite function value, is contained in the interval between minus L and plus L for some integer L. And as the previous bounds, so upper bound 2NL, where N is the number of variables, is given by Murata, and upper bound 2L is given by Kolmogorov and myself. And in this paper, so we show that the number of iterations is exactly the same as the distance between the p star, the optimal solution obtained by the algorithm, and p zero, which is the initial solution. So here we consider L infinity distance. So this means that the number of iterations of this algorithm is exactly the same as the this algorithm finds the optimal solution, which is the nearest from the initial solution, P0. And from this theorem, we see that the trajectory of the vector P, so this trajectory, is nothing but the shortest path from the initial solution to an optimal solution. So this is our result. And we can also obtain similar result for steepest descent up and down. But our statement is a little bit complicated. And the number of, exact number of iterations required by this algorithm is given by the sum of these two terms. So in the first term, we consider the maximum of zero and the difference of components P star I and P zero I. Here P star is the optimal solution obtained by the algorithm, and P zero is the initial solution. And so this value corresponds to this value in this case. So P star I minus P zero I corresponds to this value. And similarly, the second term corresponds to this distance between P zero I and P star I. And in fact, this value is also a satisfied axiom of distance. So this theorem also shows that the algorithm steepest descent up and down finds the optimal solution, which is the nearest from the initial solution. So this is the main result of the first part of my talk. And so, OK. Yes, of course, yeah, we can use absolute value instead of this one.
So if P star I is bigger than P zero I, then the second term, the green arrow, is zero.
Yes.
And the first term is exactly that. Right?
Maximum of I.
The maximum of I.
Yes.
Inside.
Yes. So is there any question? And so, yeah, here it shows a useful property to obtain the exact number of iterations. So that is so. We use a property of elliptic convex function like this. And here we consider two integral vectors P and Q, which is indicated by this red line and blue line. And here we also consider a set of components X, which give which corresponds to the maximizers of pi minus qi. So in this picture, so X corresponds to these components. And for p, q, and x, we have this inequality. Here, so left-hand side is the sum of gp and gq. And the right-hand side is the sum of the function value at p minus ex. So ex is characteristic vector of x. So p minus ex correspond to this line, so obtained by subtracting characteristic vector from p, so corresponding to this line. And q plus ex corresponds to this blue line. So this inequality means that the sum of the function value decreases or not increasing by approaching to each other. And by using this property, we can obtain the exact number of iterations. So this is the end of my first part, end of the first part of my talk. And easily explain the application to auction theory. So first, I explain the auction setting in my talk. So here we consider n discrete items, 1 to n, like these tablet PCs. And we assume that for each item, only one unit is available. And we also consider m bidders, 1 to m. And each bidder has his own variation function, fi. And for item set S, fi of S represents the value of item set S. And when we are given a price vector, p1, p2 to pn, then each bidder wants to maximize his payoff, which is given by the value of item set S minus the total sum of prices of items in S. And we denote by DIP the argmax of the payoff, so as maximizers of payoff. And it is often called demand correspondence. And here we define an important concept in auction theory called variation equilibrium prices, which is a price vector given satisfying this condition. And this condition says that there exists a partition of item set, S1 star, S2 star to SM star, such that each set SI star is maximized payoff of bidder I for all bidder 1 to M. So this definition means that the equilibrium price is so best desirable price for all bidders and also auctioneer, since all items are sold out. So we want to find such a nice price vector, but it is not always the case that variation equilibrium exists. Indeed, so even if each variation functions are some modular function, so it is possible that variation equilibrium does not exist. But it is shown by Kelsen and Crawford that if each variation function satisfies a condition called gross substitute condition, then variation equilibrium always exists. And also, gross substitute condition is known to be almost necessary condition for the existence of equilibrium. And here we, so this is the definition of gross substitute condition. And in the definition, we consider two price vectors, P and Q. Q is obtained by increasing the price of some item, J. And here we also consider item set X, which is the which maximizes the payoff with respect to price vector Q. Then this condition says that there exists another item set Y, which maximizes the payoff with respect to the another price vector Q, such that each item in X, except for J, J is the item appearing here, is contained in item set Y. So it's a little bit difficult, but intuitively it is not so difficult. So it means that, for example, if the price of iPad becomes higher, then we have more demand for other tablet PCs. So in that sense, this is a natural condition for variation functions. And we can explain iterative auction. So iterative auction is a protocol or an algorithm for finding equilibrium prices and also allocation of items. And iterative auction repeatedly update price vector by using bidder reported information. And outline of iterative auction is like this. So here, algorithm corresponds to the auctioneer. And first, we set initial prices appropriately. And in each iteration, we ask all bidders to report their demand correspondence, that is the set of maximizers of their payoff. And then we check if the partition of item set satisfying the condition of equilibrium. And if there is such a partition, then we stop the algorithm, and the current price vector is an equilibrium. And otherwise, we update price vector appropriately and go back to step one. And this is the outline of iterative auction. And it is called ascending auction if the price vector increases monotonically in each iteration. And we then explain the concept of Lyapunov function introduced by Hausdorff. The Lyapunov function is a function in price vector P, which is defined by this formula. Here, the first term is the sum of all items, a sum of the price for all items. And the second term is the sum of indirect utility function for all bidders. And indirect utility function VI of P is given by the maximum payoff with respect to the price vector P. And Hausdorff showed that Lyapunov function has various nice properties like this. First, this function, Lyapunov function is some modular function on the real vector space. And second, a vector P is a minimizer of the Lyapunov function if and only if it is an equilibrium price vector. And third, there exists an integral minimizer of the Lyapunov function. So from these properties, we see that iterative auctions can be regarded as minimization algorithms for Lyapunov functions. And based on this observation, this understanding, Hausdorff proposed this ascending auction, which tried to minimize the Lyapunov function iteratively. So initially, price vector is said to be a sufficiently small integral vector, so typically set to zero vector. And in each iteration, we find the item set which minimizes this function values. So L of P plus EX. So in step one, so we minimize the Lyapunov function locally. And if it is locally minimum, then we can stop the algorithm since we can show that P is equilibrium. Otherwise, we update P by P plus EX and go back to step one. So this is ascending auction by Hausdorff. And in the following, we analyze this auction from the viewpoint of a discrete convex analysis. And here we mention the connection between auction theory and discrete convex analysis. So let us recall that the gross surface condition implies the existence of variation equilibrium, and which is given by this property. And the connection between auction theory and discrete convex analysis is started by this theorem by Fujishige and Yang, and it shows that the gross surface condition for variation functions is equivalent to M natural concavity, so negative of M natural convexity. So due to this theorem, connection between auction theory and discrete convexity, discrete convex analysis established, and so in particular, we can use various non-result in discrete convex analysis to auction theory. And here I explain our second result, and we provide a new view to iterative auction from the viewpoint of discrete convex analysis. So this is a summary of the correspondence between auction theory and discrete convex analysis. So first, for variation functions, gross surface condition is equivalent to M natural concavity. And indirect utility function and Lyapunov functions are L-natural convex function. So Lyapunov function minimization can be regarded as a special case of L-natural convex function minimization, and iterative auctions can be regarded as a special case of L-natural convex function minimization algorithms. So in the following slide, we explain these correspondence in more detail. And so important thing is that so discrete convex analysis is useful also in auction theory. So here we analyze the ascending auction of Asbel by discrete convex analysis. So as I told in the previous slide, gross surface condition for variation function is equivalent to M natural concavity. And combining this theorem and the conjugacy theorem in discrete convex analysis, we obtain this theorem stating that indirect utility function is L-natural convex if and only if variation function is satisfied gross surface condition. And as a corollary of this theorem, we can show that the Lyapunov function is L-natural convex function. So we can regard ascending auction of Asbel as a special case of steepest descent up for L-natural convex function minimization. So we can apply the theorem which I showed in the first part of my talk. So we can obtain the exact band for the number of iterations required by ascending auction, which is given by like this. So the exact number of iterations is given by the minimum distance between initial solution P0 and the nearest integral equilibrium P star. So this is the main result in the second part. And also, so by using connection between auction theory and discrete convex analysis, we can consider different kinds of iterative auctions. So we have shown that ascending auction of Asbel is a special can be seen as a special case of steepest descent up. And Asbel also proposed a descending auction where price vector decreases monotonically, and it can be seen as a special case of steepest descent down for L-natural convex function minimization. So important merit of these iterative auctions is that price vectors moves monotonically increasing or monotonically decreasing, which is an important property for iterative auctions. But the demerit is that we need to take sufficiently small or sufficiently large initial prices, which makes the number of iterations bigger. So we propose a new iterative auction, which we call greedy auction, which is an application of the steepest descent up and down to the Lyapunov function. A merit of this iterative auction is that we can use arbitrary initial prices, which makes the number of iterations small. But the demerit of this iterative auction is that prices moves up and down, which is not good as an iterative auction. So we also propose another iterative auction, which we call two-phase auction. It's a combination of ascending auction and descending auction. And in the next slide, explains in more detail. So this is an outline of two-phase auction. And we can start from any integral vectors. And in the first part of this iterative auction, we apply ascending auction, so price vector increases monotonically. Then we, and if we reach the local minimum point, then we go to the descending phase where price vector decreases monotonically. And merit of this iterative auction is that any initial vector can be used, and the price vector moves almost monotonically. So first monotonically increasing and then decreasing. And the demerit is that it requires more iterations than greedy auction, but it is not large, and you can show that the number of iterations is at most the 3 times of the number of iterations by greedy auction. So this is the end of my talk, and this is a summary of the second part. So thanks for your attention.
Yes.
So suppose that we can get the correct information about the demand correspondence, and then we can it is difficult to compute the function value of Lyapunov function, but we can compute the difference of function values from the demand correspondence. So here we consider this function value, but instead of this function value, we consider the difference of this value minus L of B, and which can be computed by maximize the linear function corresponding to EEX over the demand correspondence given by all bidders. So if we know the correct information of all bidders demand correspondence, then we can compute the difference of function values, so it can be implemented.
Didn't that mean that step one is the modular function?
Yes, that's correct.
The point here is that in option context, we cannot have function value for us. But usually, they assume that the maximizer, so they call it demand set, demand correspondence, they are given. So we need to consider how to implement some modular function minimization using all the demand correspondence. And that can be done.
If you glue together the globalized extensions for an L-convex function, does that give you a convex extension?
So you mean so for Lyapunov function? Yeah, yes, that's correct. Yes.
The partial answer to this question is that in fact in step one you do not need to minimize the function. You just need to get the decrease. As long as you get the decrease, the algorithm could work.
The number of iterations
might be a little larger.
No, I ask for the obvious question.
Yes. Yes, it is also shown by Kazuo Murata in the original paper on discrete convex analysis.
So subgradients of the globalized extension give you subgradients of the whole function?
Not exactly, because of globalized extension so deal with a set of Dedekind vectors, so unit hypercubes, so when we consider subgradients, we need to consider the whole space. Mm-hmm. But so we already know the complete representation of the subgradient of L natural convex function. So it is given as a set of vectors in base polyhedron. So we know the complete characterization subgradient.
Okay, so any others? No? Yes.
Which one?
The number of iterations.
Ah, okay.
The very first level.
Okay.
Well, yeah. Here the point is that the P is not, P star is actually, so you said this is the output of the algorithm. But what is really true is the number of iterations is equal to minimum distance from the starting point. The minimizer. And P star is one of those